to walk by faith. There'll always be the mountains and valleys in our way. But right here in this moment, may our strength be renewed as we recall what God has done and how we've seen Him move. If there's anybody here who's found Him faithful, anybody here who knows He's able, say amen. If there's anybody here who's seen His power, anybody here brought through the fire, say amen.
But be bold and courageous and follow where He leads, 'cause greater is the one who's in us than he who's in the world. So child of God, remember the battle is the Lord. If there's anybody here who's found Him faithful, anybody here who knows He's
being raised. In a battle I can never The friends I had were nowhere to be found. couldn't see it then, but I can see it.
Look together at Daniel chapter number 4. It's been a good place to be.
Oh, yeah.
Chris told me the singing lineup today. I said, those are all bangers. Boy, were they, amen. The direction I was going around Monday to about 4 o'clock yesterday, I was going to preach a sermon series called Shake It Off. And Shake It Off. Is it going through your head yet? That was for you, Jonathan. Man, your pastor loves you. But the Lord intervened and gave me something different for this crowd. That may never get preached. But it, just know this, it's a really good one. Amen. It's a real good one. We'll keep it in our back pocket for maybe in September sometime. But God knew somebody was here that needed this. And it could just be the one that, testified today. But this message is something that God hit me with and helped me with and was working on me throughout the week. It's kind of a weird text, if you will. It's in Daniel chapter 4. If you've never read Daniel chapter 4, you ought to. Amen. If you've ever read The Inquirer, y'all, anybody in here ever remember back, you go through Kmart, you walk down the aisle, nobody knows what Kmart is anymore. And on the sides, they had the National Enquirer there. And it had all the things weird in it. If I could find a magazine to print Daniel chapter number 4, it'd be in the Enquirer, amen? It would not be on the Times, amen? It would definitely be an Enquirer kind of message because it is a weird chapter of Scripture. The main character is King Nebuchadnezzar. He's actually writing this text, if you will. And he's writing it and giving it over to Daniel, and Daniel would be the one who would place it within the book and also add some thoughts throughout the text to kind of give a little bit more of understanding through it. But instead of taking this account and just telling you the events of a horrific time in his life and the details of the tragedy that he went through for 7 years, he decided that he would show you an open door to his life of a dream that would lead to tragedy, that would lead to success. And ladies and gentlemen, sometimes God gives us a dream to pursue after, but it doesn't always go the way that we want it to, and it ends in a way that we don't like. But then all things at the very end are according to God's will. So let's stand together for the reading of God's word, and we'll read it, then we'll apply its truths to ours, and we'll go to Domino's. Amen? It says this in verse number 28. It says, "And all at this time period, up until verse 27 to 28, he has a dream. He goes to the sorcerers. They can't tell him the dream. He goes to Daniel, tells him the dream. Daniel then tells him the exact interpretation of the dream. Now we're caught up. The Bible says all this came unto Nebuchadnezzar, King Nebuchadnezzar, at the end of 12 months, a whole year after Daniel had his little talk with him. Just a year later, he walked into the palace of the kingdom of Babylon, and he spake, and this is what he said. Take note for a second of what he said. Is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? While the word was in the king's mouth, there fell a voice from heaven, saying, O King Nebuchadnezzar, to thee it is spoken, the kingdom is departed from thee. And they shall drive thee from men, and thy dwelling shall be with the beast of the field, and they shall make thee to eat grass as the oxen. And 7 times shall pass over thee that 7 years, until thou know that the Most High ruleth in the kingdom of men and giveth it to whomever he will. The same hour was this thing fulfilled upon Nebuchadnezzar, and he was driven from men and did eat grass of oxen, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven till his hair was grown like eagle's feathers. Now you getting the National Enquirer yet? And his nails like birds' claws. And at the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted up mine eyes to heaven,
and my understanding returned unto me.
Yeah.
And I blessed the Lord Most High, and I praised and honored Him that liveth forever, whose dominion is everlasting dominion, and His kingdom is from generation to generation. Lord, we thank You for this day. We thank You for being so good to us. God, I ask You, Lord, that You'd meet with us. Man, how wonderful it was to have You walk around during the worship service, just touching hearts and changing lives. And God, I pray that we would not hinder You from doing Your work, but instead of working separately, God, let us find where Your working and get in on it. Lord, I pray that You'd empty me of self and sin, fill me with Your Spirit, because today is the Super Bowl. And I pray that together, Lord Jesus, we leave no doubt, for it's in Your name we pray. Amen. And you may be seated. There is so much to this story. There's so many applications. There's so many lessons that could be applied to the lives of a prideful man. Amen. There's so much going on here that we just don't have time to recognize it all. And but out of all this, it would do us some good to recognize this one thing, that God doesn't throw us away.
Amen.
Let me say it again. It'd do us all some good to recognize that we may mess up once in a while. We may make some mistakes. We may get prideful in our spirit. But ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you this. Just because you mess up, just because you miss the mark, does not mean that God turns His back on you. Doesn't mean that God gives you over to the devil. Doesn't mean that God quit on you. But ladies and gentlemen, I come out of bed this morning to tell you this, that God does not give up on His children.
Amen.
You see this? Look at this. Look at this. The Bible. Let's just do a quick survey of what's going on here, just so you know what I'm about to flip something. Amen.
Yes.
And if you don't know where I'm going, or and how I got to where I got, then we lost. That ain't good preaching. Amen. So I need to get you to where I am, so that we can flip things together. Amen.
Amen.
We're just gonna take a quick survey before we attempt to apply this to our lives. Upon completion of this interpretation of the dream, we need to notice in verse number 27 that Daniel would tell this man, he would say, wherefore, King Agrippa, or O King, let my counsel be acceptable unto thee. All that I said make it acceptable to thee. He said, but I got a prescription for you. I got something that'll fix what you got messed up.
Yes.
He said that, and break off thy sin by righteousness, and thine iniquity by showing mercy to the poor. If it may be a lengthening of thy tranquility. Right. In other words, he's saying this. He said, listen, this is the prophecy for your life, but it is not the final destination of your life. What you've experienced before, you can experience again. You have to break off some things in your life. You're a sinful man. You need to leave sin. And you are a man who needs to learn how to serve other people. If you want to lengthen the happiness and joy in your life, ladies and gentlemen, it's time that you leave your sin and start serving others.
Yeah, there you go.
Mm. You see, this is the pride that or the prescription that favored him. In verse number 30, you're going to find a pride that forced him. Verse 30 says this, the king spake and said, is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power, for the honor of my majesty? He said, it's me who's done all of this. I'm the one who built this house. I'm the one who built this kingdom. I put in the work. I made sure that all of the soldiers would battle the right way. I'm the one who put the generals in place. I'm the one who set up the walls. I'm the one who built the magnificent kingdom that we experienced. I'm the one who hung the gardens. I'm the one who keeps them going. I'm the one who put this place on the map. It is me and me only. You see, his pride forced him into making a statement that would be destructive to him. And ladies and gentlemen, I know this to be true. Let me close my eyes. There are some who have allowed themselves to build up with pride over some things that they think they're doing. I was mean last week. We'll go on here in a minute. I don't be mean twice in a row. Trust me. We did that once. It was a rough day. Nobody come the third week. Matter of fact, I even stayed home. I hurt my own feelings. Amen. See, when you have pride that forces you, you also have pain that finds you.
Yeah.
Look at this. Verse 33. That same hour, the thing was fulfilled upon Nebuchadnezzar, and he was driven from men. He was pushed out. He was no longer the king. He was now out in the field eating the grass like an ox, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven, and his hair grew like eagle's feathers, and his nails like bird's claws. Now, that's just weird, isn't it? This is stuff you find on Netflix. Amen? Amen. Right? Stranger Things could take a note from this, couldn't they? They just call it weird things after that. Not strange anymore, just straight weird. Look at this. He said he has a pain here. Could you just imagine? You just left the throne, the place that was yours, and now you're in a field controlled by another person, eating grass because you don't have the brains to eat what you're supposed to eat. You don't have the body to do what you're supposed to do. And your life is now just secluded to the field. And in the field, you're going to have to go through some things. Ladies and gentlemen, there was a purpose that was found here. And I want to tell you this. The field was the place where God would educate Nebuchadnezzar through his own hands. He said, ladies and gentlemen, there was a purpose that Nebuchadnezzar was in the field. I want to tell you this. There's people under the sound of my voice that are going through things in their life that they never thought they would experience.
Sure.
Pain has driven their life. Hurt. Somebody's talked about you. You've been mistreated. Life has gotten complicated. Your marriage has gotten weird. Your relationship with your children has gone cattywampus. You've got crazy children. You've got teenagers. That's all you got to say about it. You got teenagers. And teenagers are bipolar by nature. Amen. They're so polar, they're tripolar. Amen. They can start the day happy, end the day mad, but in between, they're everything. Can I get a witness? Anybody? Y'all supposed to say amen. I'm with you. I feel you. I know what you're thinking. I'm just like you. I'm still 12, 13, and 14. I'm all things. But the field. We could go around the room and I could introduce some people to you who's been through the field.
Yes.
I don't mean you grew feathers. Amen. Some of you do you some good to get some featherage. Amen. Some down on you. Some of you are down. Amen. Then there's some other people in here who's experienced some things in their life. They just didn't know that they would ever get out of that field. You see, that field is not a wonderful place. It's not a great place. And this, nobody gets excited about going through something. But ladies and gentlemen, it is in the field that God does his work. You see, the devil may do it to you, but God has a purpose for you. He started in a king as a king, landed in feathers, but everything changed again whenever he walked through the field. And today I want to talk to you about that. You see, God has prepared a field for many of us in this room today. Some of us may be in it, some may be getting ready to go in it, and some may have already come through it. But everybody in here has something that is like just too heavy for them. What do you do, preacher? What happens when God places you in the field? What happens when the have a field of pain? What happens when I have a field of problem, when the cancer comes, when financial woes come, when I have troubles in my life, when I have situations that overcome me? What's happening? I'm going to give you two truths today that'll help you understand what happens, what God is doing, what God can do in the field. What happens when God places you in a field? Number one, when God places you in a field, then He has a time for you. He has a time that is on His side. You see, He has a time of completion. And notice this. Nebuchadnezzar's out on the field. The former king is now grazing in the grass. Now he's just like a common beast. And he's been this way for 7 years. But look at verse number 34. It says this, and at the end of the days. At the very end of it, I, Nebuchadnezzar, the one who's writing this, with my hand lifted up my eyes unto heaven, and my understanding returned to me. He said, I've been like this for 7 long years. I've been living like this for 7 long years. I've been living like a beast in the field for 7 years. Everyone had given up on me. They put me out the pasture, ladies and gentlemen. I lost my family. I lost my friends. I lost my people. I lost my palace. I lost my kingdom. I lost it all. And I'm living alone out in the woods, out in the field, out in this terrible place. And he said, but then I was just munching around on some grass, and I got the looking up, and I got the seeing, and when I looked up into heaven, everything changed. When I stopped looking down at the dirt, when I stopped looking down at the grass, when I started looking up to the heavens, I started seeing a change in my life. How many know this, that when they stop looking at things down here and start looking at things up there, everything changes in their lives? He said this. I said, I looked up and it all changed. Everything changed in my life. It had been 7 long years.
Yeah.
7 long years.
Thank you, Lord.
That number 7 in the Bible is kind of fun. It, I ain't going to get in numerology because that's just for weird people. I don't know it. I don't fully understand it. But I do know this. There's something about 7 in the Bible. 7 is what they call the number of completion. It was on the 7th day that God completed it all and took a break. Amen? That's in the book of Genesis. And listen, there's 7 churches or 7 church ages that are described in the book of Revelation, right? There are 7 seals of judgment that will be opened. And with that, there are 7 vows that will be opened and poured out on man as the judgment of God falls. 7. You say, why is it 7? Because it's complete. It's done.
Yes.
I started thinking about this and I got a little loose. Amen.
Absolutely.
I got fired up. You say, why? Because whenever he was down in the grass, munching on the grass, looking down, he looked up and he saw on the 7th, I believe this with all of my heart, on the very day that God made him a beast in the field was the very day that God made him a king again 7 years later. You say, how do you know that? I don't know that. You say, why would you care? Because it was at that 7th year, the mark of completion, that everything changed. What if I were to tell you that when you got put in the field, God already had a completion date for your life?
Absolutely.
You say, preacher, when is it time? When is the completion? When is it over? I broke another watch band. Look at that. I'm just tossing you all kinds of stuff. Finally, I could buy some new watch bands. I went through all of them. This is what happens when you buy them on Amazon. Amen. I'm going to try Timu Mizumi now. Make my first Timu Mizumi purchase. What were we talking about? You're supposed to tell me. Well, that's it. When's it complete? When's it over? I can't tell you that. The watch is done. Finite, finished. But it ain't. I can't tell you that. I'm your preacher. I'd love to tell you that your financial situation is going to be better tomorrow.
I'd love to tell you that your boss won't be an idiot tomorrow and you're going to get a raise. I'm not Joe Osteen. I ain't going to smile at you and lie. Amen. I'm going to tell you the truth. I don't have a clue. Listen, I don't have a clue when your marriage is going to get better. I mean, I could give you some steps to make it better. We're going to do that at the end of the month on the 27th, on a Tuesday at 6:30. If you want to be here, we'll help you. I forgot y'all perfect. Y'all need no marriage love. Amen. But for us broke people, we're going to be in here going through it together. What are we talking about? Please, in the name of God. The other day, a couple weeks ago, Sydney's gluten-free now. That means she can't have anything good. I feel, listen, we go down the road driving. Y'all experience this. You go down the road, you just, I'm hungry. And you're like, I can eat this, and I can eat this, I can eat this, but none of it's gluten-free. It's so annoying. And I'm naming stuff. We end up going to get her an unwich. Because unwich means it ain't no witch. Amen? It's just un. Just un. Poor girl. But I was having a rough day. I dropped a line to her. Y'all ever done this? Oh, I sure would like to have. And you know what I mean? Insert things that make you feel so good. I said, I sure would like to have some cornbread. She goes, well, I'm sure you would. I said, I wish I had some cornbread. I said, if I had cornbread today, I think it'd make everything better. Sydney makes the best cornbread. It's sweet. And then we take some of that butter and you put it on top of it about this thick all the way across. Whenever I'm done putting the butter on it, Brother Mike, I tell you, it looks like somebody cut a fresh piece of cake with icing on it. I mean, butter is the best icing, amen? There it is, that wonderful wedge just sitting there. And I'm thinking, Sydney, I think I'd feel better if you make me some cornbread. She said, okay, I'll make you some cornbread if you just shut up. So I'm outside cooking sausages on the grill, and I come inside and I smell heaven. She goes, Corey, will you check the cornbread? You want me to do what? Check the cornbread. I said, okay. She's in the other room. I go in there. It's still there. Still in the oven. She said, Corey, you need to check that cornbread to tell me what it looks like. I said, listen, Sydney, when you mixed it up and put it in this thing, it was all jellified. I said, I wouldn't eat it then. She said, right? I said, well, I don't know what I'm looking at because I look like I'd eat it right now. She said, well, do me a favor. Look closer. And I looked closer, Brother Bill, and it just looked delicious. Finally, she got frustrated at me. She said, let me look. She pushed me out of the way. Said, let me look at my cornbread. Now, it's not my cornbread. It's her cornbread. She looked. She did this little number. She grabbed it with her little oven mitt, shook it, and it wiggled in the middle. She said, see, it ain't done yet. I said, how do you know when it's done? She said, when it ain't jiggling. So, about 3 minutes later, she come back in there, and she pulled it out of the oven, set it down, and I went. It wasn't wiggling. I said, yep, looks done to me, and walked off. You said, preacher, why are you talking like that? Because you say this, preacher, why or how long will I be in the situation, in the field? How long will I be rooting around like a beast? How long will I experience what I'm going through? Ladies and gentlemen, I can't tell you how long it'll be, but I can say this. There is one who sits on the throne in heaven who knows all about it. You're his cornbread, and you're going to sit in there till you don't jiggle no more, till you have something solid about it.
about you till you look like what you were created to look like. You might as well just stay in there. Stop fussing about it. Stop worrying about it. And just say, God, I'm planted right here where you put me until you put some butter on me and put me on a plate, because you have something better for my life. How many's thankful that God has a date of completion for the trials that we go through? Look at this. This is the last thing. And I'm done, I think. I'm hungry. Seth loves whenever I talk about food, but it's getting worse. My cholesterol's getting low. I can feel something happening inside of me. I need something. Look at this. What happens when God places you in a field? When God places you in the field, He has a time of completion in mind for you. But not only that, but He has there is a transformation of your conversation.
Sure.
Look at this. Verse 34 continues on. He says this. And I blessed the Most High, and I praised and honored Him that liveth forever, whose dominion is an everlasting dominion. His kingdom is from generation to generation. Before, 7 years ago, before this,
yeah,
his conversation was this. Is this not Babylon, the place that I've built with my hands? Is this not my kingdom? Did I not do this with my power? Do I not have majesty? Now he's saying this 7 years later. God, it's his kingdom. God, it's his throne. God, it's his dominion. You see, whenever he looked up and saw heaven, he recognized that it was no longer his. It was no longer his to hold anymore, but it was God's throne all along. It was God's kingdom all along. And he took his pride that he had inside and set it to the side, because now he recognized who God was in his life, and his conversation changed because he had an encounter with the God Almighty. You say, preacher, how do you know when somebody's finally seen a change in their life? Whenever they're finally out of the field, they stop talking about them and start talking about him.
Amen.
You know what I get tired of, Mike? I get tired of people talking about themselves. I'm tired. I'm burnt out. I've done this. I've done that. Ladies and gentlemen, your pride did all that. What's the Bible say about pride? It comes before what?
Fall.
Fall. It comes before a fall. You better take the eye out your mouth and put him back in.
That's right.
You didn't do nothing. You see, because if you're really changed, if you've really been transformed,
you do it.
You're going to talk about him a lot more. This Wednesday night, it was a normal Wednesday night. I felt like it was just a normal church service. Odd sermon to preach to the congregation that God sent. And I was going, why did you do this? Why did you give me this for this congregation? But he was already working. He had a plan. Somebody got saved. Amen. To the glory of God. It wasn't a salvation kind of message. But the last point, I figured out why I had to preach that sermon, because the last point was for me.
That's how it works.
Last point was this: remember where he found you. And I don't know if you know this, but preaching's easy. Pastoring's hard. Preaching is preparing a text, presenting a text, and walking out the door. Pastoring is crawling down in the midst of the ugly and experiencing that with other people. Crying over people who won't cry over themselves. Feeling pain about a situation or a statement that you made or they made that they don't even care about. Carrying decisions that are obvious. Should we do this? Probably. Be a good choice. Should we get a new air conditioner? Is it hot? Yeah, let's do it. little things had hit all summer long, little things. So by Wednesday, I'll be honest, I was tired. And I just said, I can't do this anymore. I'm just tired. I don't want to. I was empty. There's a difference between burnout and empty. Empty means you used to have fuel in there, and now you need to go back to the gas station. Burnout is this. You're on the side of the road, and flames are kicking up. I've been empty. I was empty when I come in here on Wednesday. And then I started thinking about where he failed me. God said, just tell them where I found you. And I started testifying a little bit. I said, he found me at Fairhaven Baptist Church on a deacon's chair, lost as a teenager who played the game of church. But what I didn't say is, he found me in the middle of depression with suicidal thoughts. He found me as a dyslexic boy who had no purpose, no dream, no desire other than playing sports, who was lost and did not know who he was and was afraid that somebody would find out about him first. A person who had so many insecurities and so much anxiety, and he was the funny kid who played games and played church and tried to put on a fake facade. I remembered who that kid was, and I remember how bad that kid had it, and I remember how lost that kid was with all of the people that were around him that loved him and cared about him, and he still was lost. But I remember the time. I remember the time when the Lord Jesus Christ walked the aisles of Fairhaven Baptist Church and sat down beside that little depressed boy, that little lonely boy, that little teenage punk that should have been on his way to hell. But God said this, out of the gates of hell, out of the midst of the field, I got a purpose and a plan for your life. I'm no longer going to keep you like you was, but I'm going to change you. And ladies and gentlemen, out of the midst of suicidal thoughts, out of the middle of depression, God reached down and grabbed me. I remember where I was when he found me, and he changed everything about me. I'm thankful today that I met somebody like him. How many's thankful that they got a God who can transform even you today? You see, where you are ain't where God is taking you. You may be in the field. You may be rooting around like a beast. But God has a plan for this part. Your marriage may be going through tragedy. God's got a plan for this. Your family may be in shambles. God's got a plan for this. Your finances may be fragile, but God has a plan for this. You say, I don't know what my work's going to be like. God has a plan for it. You say, I don't know what my future's going to be like. God has a plan for it. You say, I don't know where God's going to send me. God's got a plan for it. God's got a plan today. And how many's thankful that it is a plan? God says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, saith the Lord, thoughts of good and not of evil, to bring about an established end. He's already got in mind what he wants for your life. Amen. Already. Why are you sitting there running from what God is doing? Every last one of us ought to run to this altar and say, God, I don't know what you're doing, but I'm asking you to use this time in my life to transform me to be who you want me to be. With every head bowed and every eye closed, nobody looking around. I don't know who you are today. I don't know what you've been through. I don't know what you're going through. But I've met Jesus. And I've been through some things with him that has changed everything.
Yes, sir.
You say, preacher, do you still get depressed?
Yeah.
Do you still get angry? Yeah. Do you still have frustrations? Yeah. Do you still have anxiety? Yeah. Do you still get stressed? Yeah. You said, but what's the difference now? I got somebody to walk with me through it. I'm not alone. If you're here today and you say this, I'm thankful that I have Jesus in my life. He saved me. I gave my heart to him. And I'm going to raise my hand in thankfulness today that if Jesus comes or I should die, I'm ready to meet him. Here's my hand to the glory of God. Maybe you're here today and you say this, preacher, I don't know if I've ever been saved, but I sure would like to know.
I'd like to know that Savior you're talking about, the one that changed your life. Here's my hand. Amen. Preacher, will you pray for me? That where I am, God has a time in mind of when it's going to be over. Amen. Preacher, will you pray for me that at the end of this, there's a transformation, a change in my life, a direction that God has given me for strength. Will you pray for me, preacher? Amen. Amen. How about we do this? So many hands around the room. So much going on. So many changes. So many lives that are going through something. I promise I'm going to pray for you, but what I think you ought to do today is step out of this seat, come down to this altar, and call on Jesus Christ, the only one who can do it all. The Bible calls him the author and finisher of our faith. It's him who's writing the story, so you might as well get a hold of him who holds the pen. This one's come. How about you? Won't you come? I'm coming to you, Jesus, for a new timeline. I'm coming to you for a transformation. I'm coming to you for a change, because I don't want to be like I am right now. And I'm thankful that you have an end in mind for me. And you have a place of change in my life. God, transform me. Church today, how could we ever not give you the praise? God, I'm thankful that I get to go to a church that ain't afraid to let their hair down, that ain't afraid to let their vulnerabilities shine, their insecurities pop out, so that we can see change. Lord, let us not be a church that grows cold to you. Let us not be a church that begins to be judgmental of those that fall on the altar and call out to you. But we are a church that surrounds other people with the power of prayer and change. God, Lord, let us always seek you in the middle of it all. You are wonderful. Lord, for those beasts that are in the field today, God, I pray that you, Lord, you let them look up and let them see that you still on the throne today, and you have a plan and a transformation coming. Lord, we love you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, I want to thank those of you who are here for the first time. If you're here for the first time, I'd like to be able to tell you it ain't always like this, but I'm here to tell you it's pretty much always like this. God does a wonderful work here. We're thankful for it. If this isn't your cup of tea, we're sorry. But we want you to come back. And I promise you this, you sit long enough, it'll become your cup of tea. Amen. Amen. Just want to remind some things, or give some reminders, and then we're going to jump back here. Where did my buddy go? We're going to baptize. Is it Dwayne? Is that your name? Huh?
Yes.
Yes, sir. Dwayne, amen.
Cowboys just came to
Jesus Christ this last Wednesday. Said he wants to do the next step, and that's the next step is after salvation comes baptism. What is baptism? It is an outward display of what took place on the inside. We've been buried in Christ and risen a new creature. Amen. I'm not who I used to. I'm not who I used to be. And maybe I'm not who I'm going to be. But right now, I'm just thankful I ain't that guy no more.
Right, yes.
Amen. I'm praising God for who I am. Just a backpack update. We were able to serve over 100 kids at Ashford. Ashford Rumble Elementary. They went home with all the supplies that they need to have a good year, or at least half a year. We might, you know, there may be some needs later that pop up, and we're sponsoring them, so you know, if they need it, they'll just ask. And more importantly, they got an invitation to Truth Baptist Church and a gospel track in that bag, so the gospel went into the homes of over 100 people.
Wonderful.
Amen.
Wonderful.
Amen. You see, serving evangelism is this: we serve people and we drop the gospel in at the same time. Here's another opportunity for fun. This is not gender specific, just so you know. Although most of the males in the room will maybe beat their chest over this, fantasy football is back, baby. Oh. Amen. We'll be having our draft very soon. Downstairs is a sign-up sheet. If you've never played fantasy football here and you would like to this year, you come to church here, you plan on being faithful to the church, amen. We can't send a belt home with you if you ain't going to come back consistently. Amen. That's free. But there's a sign-up sheet downstairs for that, and we'll send an email. Once we get the number of how many people's playing, we'll send an email of how we're going to break that up so that everybody gets good players and we're not getting Ted Turner on our team or something like that. You know, it's still competitive and fun. On August the 28th, Francois Carr will be preaching for us.
Francois.
All the way from, amen, from Africa. North, South Africa is going to come preach for us. I'm excited about it. He's becoming a mentor to me, and he's helped me learn a lot about discipleship. And that is the 28th, I believe. It's Wednesday night.
August.
Yes, of August. That's coming up. Couple of things, the connect groups here, they'll both be here tonight at 6 for that's usually at the park, 7 or 7:30 for the True Freedom Bible Study. They'll both be downstairs. I just want to say this, for those of you who's in the park group, Caroline brings cookies. So if you guys got an oven, you could bring cornbread. Amen. I have a hankering for some cornbread now. Better Together is Tuesday the 27th. It was moved there. And look at the screen for food pantry information. I'm going to go change. Brother Chris, will you
take over? While he's getting ready, we'll go pray here in just a second. Yeah, I come home from work the other day. He's talking about that field all day. So I come home from work the other day, and I forgot to do a couple of things for my lovely bride, Decker. Bless your heart. And she said, you didn't do this. And I said, well, I've had this to do. She said, you should have been a farmer. And I said, why? She said, well, then you could be outstanding in your field. Father, thank you for this day. We ask that you would bless this baptism that's about to take place. We're thrilled for our brother as he came, and we were able to witness the movement of the Holy Spirit through this church. We pray that you would be with each and every one until such a time as we're able to be together again. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. Have a good day. Amen.